arms around us. By your grace we are no longer bound, no longer bound. You called me out of the grave, you called me into the light, you called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Oh, we're alive, cause you're alive. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light, you call my name and then my heart came to life. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens. Greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens. Above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Orlando Church of Christ, our online service. So glad you could join us today. My name's Jose Ferrer, and I'm grateful to be with you. You know, I got a couple things I want to share with you guys today, a couple updates of some things that are going on. As you know, 5 years ago, some of you may not even know, but as the church knows, 5 years ago, we planted the Space Coast Church. Tom and Karma Kuhn have been doing a great job leading out there. And earlier this year, Tom announced that he's going to be retiring. As such, a lot of people, they put it out there, and so a lot of people applied. And then the church decided to invite me to apply as well. After a lot of prayer and getting a lot of advice, I decided to apply. So my wife and I, we talked to the church out there, and long story short, we were chosen to lead the church. And so it's kind of a little bit of a mixed feeling here, but as of January 1, my wife and I will be moving to Space Coast to lead the church there. I'm really excited about it. And, you know, I think about the church here and all that we've experienced over the last 20 years and how much many of you have meant so much to us, how you've loved us, guided us, and allowed us into your lives as well. We're so grateful for all that the church has done. And so in just a moment, I'm going to pray for the offering, but I wanted to share a couple things because I think God has been doing a lot behind the scenes, and it's only recently that we've been able to see these things happen. You know, it was put on Marshall's heart several months ago, earlier this year, for him to appoint me as evangelist. Just a couple months later, God put it on Tom's heart to invite me to apply to be the evangelist there in Space Coast. And so these two trains left the station at different times, but they collided, not so much collided, but they came to the same point where it was like, I had to make a decision. And I really see in so many ways, these little footprints, I can't go into all of them, but there was these things like when I decided to fast and pray over an unrelated thing, that's the day I got the call. When Marshall decided to appoint me evangelist and then Tom wanted me to be out there, there's all these kind of little markers that made it seem like, wow, God is really doing something here. And then the craziest coincidence or providence, if you will, was on September 20th, on my 20th spiritual birthday, is when the church over there decided to interview me. And so there's all this emotion and all these things going on, and we prayed a ton and really fasted and sought God's will. And out of the three applicants that were finalized, it came down to us. And so I'm grateful for the opportunity. I'm excited to see what God will do. And the good news, as my wife keeps telling me, it's not that far. And so as we transition to the offering, I wanted to share a passage and then help us to see something that I see when I think about the Orlando church. In 2 Corinthians 8, it says this, starting in verse 1. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then, by the will of God, also to us. Though we're not poor, the church here is very generous. And I see, in this passage, I really see the heart of the Orlando church. You know, every year we do our special missions offering, and several years ago we added an earmark just for the planting of the Space Coast Church. And you and I and everyone else in this church, we gave. We gave to those special missions, and we kept blowing out that goal year after year. And because of the faithfulness of this church, the Space Coast Church was planted. And so now all these people in Brevard County get this opportunity to hear the gospel message because of your generosity. I myself have been a beneficiary of that same generosity, of being able to be on staff to serve this church over the last 9 years. And so now, because of what you've done, we get to now go and serve in Space Coast. And so, again, it's this mixed emotion. I love everybody here. This is all I've known for the last 20 years. And now we go to start a new adventure. And I just thank all of you for your love, for your prayers, and for your continued giving. Let's pray and worship together in our offering. God in heaven, I'm just in awe of you and all that you've done in this church and with your disciples, with the children of this church. God, this church has been such a generous church through so many different trials and so many different opportunities to give. Every time, no matter what the situation, she has risen to the occasion. And now, Father, you're sending us out to lead the Space Coast Church. I can't even imagine just all that you've done to orchestrate this moment. And God, now as we give our offerings, I pray that you'll continue to use them in ways that we can't even imagine as you continue to build up the Orlando Church and her influence and how she just shares your love and your light throughout this community and beyond. God, thank you so much for Jesus, who really leads us and guides us to be generous, to be considerate, to be his disciples. God, thank you for this opportunity to worship you through our offering. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust in the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing that together one more time.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, in the Savior's love, through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, weak made strong in the same. righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the
As we continue our service today, I want to let you know of some things coming up here in the Orlando Church. This next weekend is going to be our Father-Son Campout at Kelly Park. Of course, if you'd like to know more information about all these events, just go to our website, orlandochurch.org. You'll get an email about some of these events as well so that you can register for them. Then the following weekend, we're going to have several in-person events here at 2400 South Goldenrod at our facility. There's going to be a worship night on Friday night. The next night is going to be our next drive-in movie night. And then on November 15th, we are going to have outdoor services. So in the north region, here on the east side of town, right here at Goldenrod, we've got a park reserved in St. Cloud, even in Dr. Phillips. So there's all over the city, we're going to have locations where we're going to come and be together in person. And so more information to come on that. We still will have services provided on YouTube and on Facebook for those who are not yet comfortable coming to an in-person event. But I know that so many of you have also expressed the desire to finally meet together. And so we are also very excited on November 15th to be together in these locations in person. I want to congratulate Jose Ferrer as he just announced he and Yorka will be moving, and starting January 1st, Jose will be leading the church in Space Coast. And that's very exciting. You know, God really did work it out. Even with Yorka now being able to work 100% remotely, she's going to continue to work and do her job, and Jose is going to continue to serve in the full-time ministry. And the both of them are just so excited to really feel God's calling in their life and to answer that. And it's bittersweet for us, but we also feel so blessed. The church has been given to here. We've added staff in the last few years. And so to be able to appoint Jose an evangelist and send him out just feels like what happened in the Bible. And so we're very excited for that. I would also just like to say, if you feel the prompting of God and the Holy Spirit, if you'd like to go to Space Coast, gosh, I know that Jose is beloved in this church, and for many of you, your work does look very different now. And if you feel you could work remotely and go help a smaller church, certainly you can contact Jose and Yorka. If God puts that on your heart, you'd have my blessing to be able to go and strengthen that church. We're a church of more than 500 members here. They're a church of more than 50 members there. And so you may be able to do a lot of good serving God near the beach. So we're so thankful that Jose has answered God's call, and we're thankful that this transition is going to take place over the next couple months. So I wanted to let also the tribe ministry, our singles and young professionals, know that we are coming up with a plan. That ministry for Sean and I, as you know, is near and dear to our hearts. We served in just the singles ministry alone in the LA church for 4.5 years. And so we have no intention of letting that ministry go untended. And so more to come in that, but we are just so thankful for the work that we've been able to do here in what was the Edge and now the tribe ministry, and to see the strides we've made. And certainly we look to see that ministry be taken higher. Amen. You know, this has been a crazy year, and it's probably going to get a little bit crazier this week. So let me just run over some highlights from this last year. You know, this last year, seeing as we're in Florida, this has felt a little bit like the Apollo 13 mission that launched right here from Cape Canaveral. You know, as you know, if you've seen that, the Apollo 13 mission, that's where the famous quote, "Houston, we have a problem," is spawned from. But for us, You know, we launched this year the year of vision, and man, was God going to do some amazing things. We had a lot of plans, a lot of hopes, a lot of dreams that we had put before God. And then, Houston, we may have a problem. We don't know what this virus is going to do. If we all stay home for 2 weeks, it'll probably be over and we'll have a great conference. But then the COVID continued to spread globally. Throughout the world, it became apparent that all of the economies of the world were going to be impacted. Travel was going to be impacted. And so shortly after that, services here in Orlando were canceled. After May 8th or March 8th, we have not been able to meet together in person the way we used to. And sure enough, in time, it became apparent that we were going to have to postpone the World Discipleship Summit for 2 years. So we began recording services right here, and we were live streaming on Sunday mornings until we couldn't hear the audio one day, and everybody felt like they had to text Marshall to let him know that they couldn't hear the audio. That was a fun service, and so then we decided we'll just go to the building early on Saturdays or Thursdays, sometimes Tuesdays, whenever we could make it here. We've been here recording these services for the last 6-7 months. And I want to thank so much AV Matters, their team. I want to thank Jason Durfus for all the editing work he does. The raw materials we give Jason and the service you guys see on Sunday, believe me, it's two different things. There's a lot of magic that happens in the meantime. So then we had to deal with racism, and both in the church and in the news and in our country and in the world, we have seen the impact of the inequality and the issue of race has kind of come back. And I'm so grateful for Marcus and Amy Overstreet, for Brian Santos, for the Make Every Effort midweek class. I really do feel like this is an issue that we want to confront here in the Orlando church and really lead the way in reconciliation. You know, we're not going to fix the world's problems, but within the church and within the people of God, we want to see great healing and great unity. And so now we're trying to calculate, right, how to land this ship, when and how services will return. We've been doing some in-person events, the Father-Son Campout, a drive-in movie, those kind of events. Of course, you're coming at your own risk, but we really do want to provide those opportunities for our members to get some time to fellowship. And if all that were not enough, then now we are bracing for reentry into the atmosphere, or what I call the 2020 election. This happens every 4 years, but it seems like every 4 years it wants to divide and pull apart both our country, and I also think it challenges us as people of faith. And so in the Apollo 13 mission here, they were trying to brace for reentry. And you know that if you go too shallow, you skip off into space. If you go too steep, you're going to burn up. And so here's a picture of the Orlando staff, elders, and board praying for safe reentry through our election process this week. This is our staff meeting. We're there on Zoom. I think you can see Eddie and Jose and myself, Brian Santos, Barry Maddox is on Zoom. Of course, this is not a picture of us, but this is what it feels like trying to navigate this church through this time. And so, you know, my prayers for real is that we will, just as disciples, take a mature view of this time. I'm going to give you a 2-second civics lesson. Keep in mind, we are not electing a king, all right? This country was formed by those who were fleeing what they felt to be a tyrannical king and taxation without representation. And so they set up a government that was clunky, that was big. There's senators and congresspeople and an executive branch and a cabinet and a judicial system, and all have checks and balances. And it really isn't supposed to work very well. It's supposed to be a slow, clunky, inefficient government so that people can live with freedom. And that was really the idea. And why is it so inefficient? I think that's what makes some of us so frustrated, is we want it to work efficiently. And yet the founders of this country really felt like, let's set up a government that has enough checks and balances, that's inefficient, slow-moving, and really the power and the trust would be turned over to the citizens and the people of this country. And so that's the experiment that we're about 250 years into, an experiment here in America. And I hope that you pray for this country. I hope that you pray for the vote that you're going to cast, and that ultimately you would just trust in God and in His sovereignty. We have an inefficient system. Why? Well, if you've watched Hamilton, you know, like I said, we just didn't want a king. And so hopefully your allegiance, if you are a disciple of Jesus, is to not just a party, a political party, though I'm sure most of you know who you're going to vote for by this time, but our ultimate allegiance is to Christ. Our ultimate allegiance, our kingship, our lordship belongs to one person and one person only, and that is Jesus Christ. And the interesting thing is, as we continue our kingdom and empire series, is this is a king that nobody wanted when he came to earth. This is a king that nobody voted for, nobody stood by, and so the title of today's lesson is simply Christ Crucified. Our kingdom and empire series really comes down to this. It is the king on the cross, crucified. And the truth is, though, no matter how loyal we believe we are to Jesus, when it comes to this whole idea of kingdom versus empire, there's really just Christ that fully understands the kingdom of God. It's really just Christ and His relationship with God and the Holy Spirit that understand what's going on in this world in terms of His kingdom. And everybody else, when we watch the passion play out, when we watch the crucifixion of Jesus play out, everybody else is going to choose the way of the empire. All of us have fallen short. Even those who pledge to be on Team Jesus fall short. And it's always happened. We've always made that choice. God gave us a choice in the garden, and we said we'll do it our way. God gave us a choice in Egypt, and we said it's bad, but we'll manage. God gave us a choice in the desert, and we said let's find a leader and go back to Egypt. God gave us a choice in the promised land, and we said we don't want God to be our king. We want a king, and we want to be like everybody else. God gave us a choice at the moment of truth with the cross. And we said, I don't know the man. We have no king but Caesar. And Judas said, how much if I turn him over to you? And you and I are constantly given that choice now of whether we will choose allegiance to Christ or the empire. And if you don't believe me that everybody's going to choose empire, well, then let's just look at how it all played out. You know, with his disciples, this is his inner circle. This is Jesus' cabinet, right? They had the inside scoop. They actually got the first information about Jesus and his plan to go to the cross and die and raise from the dead on the third day. This was not, he wasn't pulling the wool over their eyes. He disclosed this plan to them in Matthew 16. It says, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples, he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. You know, so before anybody else knew, Jesus began to disclose these things to his disciples, his trusted inner circle. So how did it go over this plan? Well, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord. This will never happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. You don't have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. You know, I relate to Peter in this moment because this was the movement of God. This was the kingdom of God. John the Baptist had prepared the way, and then Jesus takes the stage, and Jesus begins to gain and baptize disciples. I mean, Rome, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, everything hinged on what Jesus was doing and where he was preaching and the miracles he was performing. So why is he throwing in the towel? The cross feels like such a losing proposition when our mind is set on empire. It feels like you're going against everything that is in our human nature. It goes against all the current narratives, all our current causes, all our protests, our list of demands, our desire for equality and for change. Why the cross? And you see Peter and the disciples saying, no, this will never happen to you. It's time to take a stand against Rome. It's time to take a stand against the corruption in Judaism and the high priests and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law and the Sadducees who were tired of the hypocrisy. This will never happen. This is the movement that we've all been waiting for. And I see where Peter's coming from, and yet what does Jesus say? You do not have in mind the things of God, but merely human concerns. I'm amazed at how much people believe that their cause, their candidate, is of God. I think we need to tread a little more lightly there. You may not have in mind the things of God. You may have in mind the things of men. God's ways are higher than your ways, as high as the heavens are above the earth. You know, Judas finally, he was a bit of a revolutionary. And I think sometimes we think Judas was just kind of a thief and he was tempted with money. I don't think that was it at all. I think Judas was a revolutionary. And when Jesus threw in the towel and said, I'm going to go and I'm going to die, I think he thought the revolution is over. And so he kind of turned Jesus over at that moment. I think it wasn't going the way he believed this movement should go. And so one of the 12, Judas, went to the chief priests and said, what are you willing to give me if I deliver him to him? So they counted out 30 pieces of silver. And then in the moment of truth, as Jesus went through his trial, arrest, and crucifixion, first in the garden, they were sleeping on him. Then when he was arrested, they all deserted and fled. And then, as predicted, Peter called down curses and said, I don't know this man. This is the same Peter who said, no, it's time for us to take our stand. We've got swords. Let's go. And now he doesn't know the man. So, no, even his disciples fell short and would not stand with Jesus in the moment of truth. Well, what about his own people? What about the Jews? Jesus was a Jew. He was born in a small Jewish town. Right? And so the Israelites, God's chosen, the elect, this was Jesus' home state. These were his constituents. These should have been his loyal followers, his base. Surely they're going to stand with him, right? They're going to stand with their candidate for king, especially considering the other alternative is the Roman Empire that has conquered and occupied them and exhibited untold brutality in the streets against the Jews. Well, as Jesus approached Jerusalem one final time, he saw the city and he wept over it. And he said, if only you had known on this day what would bring you peace, but it's hidden from your eyes because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. God's base has always been a fickle bunch. We are easily swayed. We have so little loyalty to God. The God who chooses us, the God who rescues us. We are like the Israelites sometime. What have you done for me lately, God? And so Jesus is now brought before his own. Before the trial, before the Romans and the Gentiles, Jesus is brought before the inner circle, the leaders, the high priests. In Matthew 26, this trial ends in the Sanhedrin with the high priest tearing his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, you've heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They answered, he is worthy of death. And as they bring him over to Pilate, Pilate says, can't find anything of worthy of capital punishment. And so he says, here's your king. Pilate says to the Jews, but they shouted, take him away and crucify him. Shall I crucify your king? Pilate asked. And here's Jesus' base saying, "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. I don't know about you, but sometimes in the election, it may just feel like it boils down to the choice of the lesser of two evils. And even in that, the people chose Barabbas. Even in that, they chose Caesar over Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We don't like Rome, but we hate this guy and what he stands for. It's an amazing story, the cross of Jesus Christ. Well, what about the masses, right? What about just the commoners? Those were sort of the highfalutin Jews. What about the common man, the everyday oppressed Israelites? Surely they're going to stand with Jesus. I mean, he's one of them. He was a carpenter, a good union guy, right? A man who worked hard, learned the trade of his father, worked till he was 30 before he went into the ministry. He was poor. He didn't own a house. He didn't come from money. The Bible even says he wasn't even that good looking, right? He was from a small town. He's one of us. But the masses are easily swayed. They're easily influenced. They believe the press. Within a short time, they buy into a new narrative about Jesus, right? As they welcome him into the city with triumphs and shouts of joy, within a short amount of time, a new narrative starts to take over the city. Did you hear the latest about Jesus? Yeah, he's great. He's been holding rallies all week at the temple courts, 3 days of debates with the Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes, and he killed it. Yeah, but there's a lot of other stuff that just came out. I guess he wants to destroy the temple. What? He said that? Yep. I mean, brick by brick. He said not one brick would be standing on another if he's elected. And he said we should pay taxes to honor Caesar. That's not what he said. I was there. He said we shouldn't pay taxes to Caesar. Well, all right, I'll give you that. We don't even know where he stands on the tax issue. And above that, I guess he claimed to be the Son of God. Did he actually say that? Yes. In a closed-door session with the Sanhedrin, he claimed to be the Son of God, so they're taking him to Pilate right now. There's going to be another rally in the Praetorium, and all of us are going, and we know what happened next. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "Well, then what do I do with Jesus, who's called the Messiah?" And Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." What about the Gentiles? I mean, you might think, well, there's no way. I mean, this is the other party. These are the unclean folks. They've been fighting, for thousands of years. But yet Jesus reached across the aisle, did he not? He healed a centurion's servant. He went into the region of the Decapolis and did miracles there. He told his own people to give to Caesar what was Caesar's. But when he's brought before Herod, a descendant of Esau, an Edomite, says they put a purple robe on him and twisted together a crown of thorns and set him on it. And they began to call out, "Hail, King of the Jews." Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling at their knees, they paid homage to him. So when he's at the hands of the Gentiles, they're getting a kick out of this. And after that, they finally off to Pilate. It says Pilate wanting to satisfy the crowd. I mean, that sounds like a true politician, right? On the one hand, he was trying to defend Jesus, but in the moment of truth, he flip-flops. It's what a lot of folks do during campaign season. They make a lot of promises. It says Pilate, wanting to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. You know, all of those are the people that played a part in real time. But I think we all know that we have to place ourselves in this narrative somewhere. Where do we place ourselves in this narrative? Well, it's you and me. It's easy to look at all the other people and point the finger. It's easy to say they did this or he did that or she said that or he failed here or they should have stood up there or certainly that group was corrupt or the Romans, they're racist against the Jews or Judas is a betrayer and Peter wimped out. It's very easy to identify the weaknesses in the other party, isn't it? But Peter explained to those who gathered around Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, some 50 days later, who likely were not there at that time, but Peter placed them there. He says, this man was handed over to you. Well, who? Well, you, me. This is where we've got to start putting ourselves in the narrative. This was God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. Peter didn't want that plan, but this was the plan of God, not the plan of men. And you and me, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. Paul says in Philippians 3 to the church there, I've often told you before and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach. Their glory is in their shame. And their mind is set on earthly things. You know, that's almost exactly what Jesus told Peter. If you remember that, Jesus told Peter, hey, you do not have in mind the things of God. You have in mind the things of men. And now Paul is saying that again, that when we have in mind the things of men, that we become an enemy of the cross. You know, what did he say to Peter when Peter's mind was set on earthly things? He says, you are a stumbling block to me. And he, again, in Philippians, an enemy of the cross. You know, this is extremist language, which is often used in elections. You hear words like racist, socialist, they're all thrown out, fascist. But this is extreme language here. An enemy of the cross, a stumbling block to Christ. You know, we talk a lot lately, especially about not really being a stumbling block to your brother and sister. You know, maybe your posts on Facebook or what you think politically or racially with all of these news events going on, or even about COVID, the things that we post, sometimes it's us blurting out our political opinions and feeling the need to be heard and arguing and dismissing others or labeling them. And I'm just wondering, I'm asking us, church, how much our mind is set on earthly things. Just think about it, because this stuff stresses me out too. I mean, I have to take personal inventory of who I like, who I don't like, who drives me nuts when they open their mouth and talk politically, you know? I mean, believe me, I'm going through all these gymnastics myself and trying to come to a place where I'm at peace with what's coming this week. And as I think about that, I think, why am I so disturbed? How much am I thinking of earthly things? And if I'm thinking of earthly things, am I a stumbling block to God's plan? Does that put me in enmity with the cross of Jesus Christ? This is me wrestling with my loyalty and lordship to Christ and being at peace that God is sovereign and that He has a plan for all of us, for the church, for our nation, for all people, all around the world, that God's plans need to prevail. I pray that we would leave the earthly things where they belong and that we would set our hearts on heaven, that we would set our hearts on the cross of Jesus Christ. Who did Jesus die for? Who did Christ die for? Well, He died for all the people we just talked about. He died for the disciples who deserted Him. He died for His own people who rejected Him. He died for the Gentiles who mocked Him. He died for the masses who condemned Him. And He died for you and me who despised Him and esteemed Him not. And what was His response to us? Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. What an amazing statement. What an amazing God we serve. This is why we're invited to make Jesus our Lord, our King. These are the kind of things that engender our loyalty to Him. Because when we were at our most disloyal, Jesus says, that's all right. I've got it. I forgive you. You didn't know what you were doing. And where is Christ now? If that weren't enough, that he would be willing to forgive us when we confess Jesus as Lord, when we are baptized into Christ and united in the death and burial and resurrection, where is he now? Well, it says, who is the one that condemns? I mean, well, we condemned him. So he's now standing at the right hand of God. Is he condemning us? No, he's not. No one. Christ Jesus, who died, and more than that, was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Isn't that amazing? Jesus is standing up there right next to God, campaigning for you. And if God comes back saying, yeah, but he denied you, she rejected you, she's not that loyal to you, she flip-flops, one day he's all about it, the next day he gives in to fear. He's got skeletons in his closet. You know what? Jesus is right there interceding for us. Jesus keeps saying to God and whispering into the ear of the Father, they're all right. I paid their debt. I'll cover their mistakes. You know, with the cross of Christ, there was never a time like this before or since where the empire was on full display. All the ugliness of mankind exhibited against a God who loved all of mankind. And so it seems to be this great defeat of the kingdom. And that's, I think, why Peter was so afraid. This will never happen to you. This is a losing proposition. The cross seems like a defeat. And yet, at the resurrection, 3 days later, all of death is conquered. All of kingdom is disarmed. All our sin is paid for. Satan, who held a 99.9% popular vote in the polls, was defeated. You know, we're going to close and take communion today, and we're going to sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And I love this song because I love the words. I also love the melody. But verse 2 is the one that always gets me because it's putting us in the narrative of the story of the cross. And I want to read it. And as we sing it together, I really want us to focus on the words. It says, behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there. Until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Brothers and sisters, I pray for this church to really rally this week, to let our lights shine this week, to let our allegiance to Christ and His Lordship be made known this week. No matter what happens on Tuesday or Wednesday or the days that follow, that it will be apparent that we are a people that are living called out, that we have accepted the invitation to live under the lordship of a good King, Jesus, a King that laid down His life for us, and a King that now sits at the right hand of God and intercedes for us. No one can deliver on their promises like Jesus Christ, our King. Let's pray for communion. Father God, we do ask for Your Holy Spirit to trouble us, God, to take us to a place where we're really called to make a decision of where our allegiance lies. Father, that if our hearts and our minds are set on earthly things, where moth and rust and so much can be taken away and destroyed, that, Father, You are asking us to let those things go. Father, please let us go. Let us be at peace this week. And let us reaffirm our allegiance to Christ the King. Father, we do ask Your prayer for peace and for safety. God, that You would look over this country and that, Father, we would trust you and your sovereign plan. That, Father, we would know that your plans are not our plans, that your wisdom is higher than our wisdom, that your ways, as high as the heavens are above the earth, are higher than our ways. So, Father, we just ask and pray that the church can shine like a city on a hill, that we can shine like light in the dark world that we live in, and that Jesus can continue to ransom many souls throughout the city of Orlando and throughout our world. Use us to really spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to every person on this earth. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen ones bring many sons to glory. Sure.